Well, some of the biggest events in the world canceled over the coronavirus. The Vatican has closed St. Peter's Basilica. Ireland has canceled its largest St. Patrick's Day parade. And here in the U.S., events that draw in thousands of people are also getting thrown out. The South by Southwest Arts and Music Festival is already canceled, and now organizers are considering canceling a big music event in California.
Wow.
Yeah. Welcome back to the Fox 8 4 o'clock news at 4:30. I'm Chad Tucker.
And I'm Natalie Wilson, and we are joined by the director of the Forsyth County Public Health Department, Joshua Swift. So many of you have sent us questions about the coronavirus, and we're thankful that he's here to help answer some of those questions. Joshua, I know you've been bombarded, so we appreciate your time.
Yeah, thank you.
Yes. Want to get straight to the governor, kind of that new information.
Yes.
Him talking about the we as a state have the ability to test 300 people at this point in time. You think about the population, that does not sound like a lot.
Yeah.
Locally, do we have that ability to test people?
Yes, we have that ability to test people. Right now, we're asking, as far as the symptoms that constitute a test, are cough, fever, shortness of breath, and known exposure to someone who tested positive for COVID-19, or cough, fever, shortness of breath, negative flu test, which is new, and possible exposure. So if you think you've been exposed.
I see. I want to ask a quick follow-up, if you don't mind, Chad. So where should you go? If you're showing all those symptoms, I know the inclination may be to go to your primary care doctor, but what if they say, well, we're not really accepting you? Do you go to the emergency room? Do you go straight to the health department? What's sort of the flow of how you get tested or where you should go?
Well, first, let's take it a step back. We would encourage individuals to go get their information from reliable sources, from the Centers for Disease Control or the CDC or the State Department of Health and Human Services. Go to those two websites to get more information about the signs and symptoms. And then what we would encourage people to do is to call their healthcare provider. Call them first, see, discuss with them their symptoms. If you have questions, there's a 1-800 number that you can call at the state to ask questions, but we're encouraging that first. And then ideally you would go to your healthcare provider. If that doesn't work out, call your hospital. And if not, talk to your or call your local health department.
I know a lot of people have fears out there. Is it something that we really need to be worried about? Has it gotten to that level yet for us?
The biggest thing we're trying to tell people is to be prepared.
Yeah.
So the big things that we've been talking about in public health and you've heard on the news is wash your hands.
Yeah.
Keep your hands out of your mouth, nose, and eyes. Stay home when you're sick.
Right.
And then the respiratory etiquette, cover your cough, cover your sneeze, things we should be doing all
already,
the time during cold and flu season. So the thing that we are emphasizing now is individuals that are highest risk, those that are 65 years of age or older, and those with chronic diseases that could compromise their immune system, those with heart disease, lung disease, diabetes, or they're medically fragile.
But are we at that point where we need to avoid, you know, large crowds or anything like that? Or should we, if we're a healthy adult or child, should we just continue on with our daily life?
I mean, if you're a healthy adult or child, we encourage you, you know, do those things like washing your hands, covering your cough, use hand sanitizer if you can't wash your hands. Just be cognizant of that. Stay home when you're sick. Now, those individuals that are in those high-risk groups that I just mentioned, over 65 or with a chronic disease, they probably need to take a few more precautions and maybe be a little more cognizant of where they go and things like that. Again, these are the same things we would advise people during a cold and flu season as well.
Right.
See, Joshua, a big question from a lot of our viewers, schools. Let's say if there were an outbreak or if there were symptoms being shown, do you already have a protocol in place for how you would handle that? Or would you need to sort of have that reported first and then respond appropriately from there?
Well, at first, we're nowhere near that level now, but we do have plans in place, and we're working with our local partners, including the Winston-Salem Forsyth County Schools. We're working with Winston-Salem Forsyth County Emergency Management, county and city government, as well as our hospitals and our local partners.
So you already have plans in place in the event this
was
to ask.
We've had these plans in place for decades. We regularly do drills and exercises to work through those plans. We have regular meetings, but with COVID-19, since that emerged in late December, since January, we've been having calls with the State Division of Public Health, plus we've been having meetings and conference calls with our local partners.
I see. So it's an ongoing conversation as you get more information daily. It seems to change daily.
Yes, we're staying abreast of information. We have, like I said, weekly, daily conference calls, and we are trying to stay abreast of the information because it does change. does change. And that's why we would encourage the general public to go to those two websites, the Centers for Disease Control, as well as the Department of Health and Human Services. They have dedicated pages to COVID-19 where you can get the up-to-date information.
All right. Well, thank you so much for stopping by and giving us a perspective, and especially it's good to know that you guys are always prepared and ready in the event something like this happens.
Yes, thank you.
That's right. Thank you. We appreciate the time.
Thank you.
Well, this outbreak could also